So now we know a little bit about this process of converting a specific gene into a protein. We need to think about how a cell controls which genes that it expresses at what time. So if we take our restaurant analogy, how does the restaurant know that it's breakfast or lunch or dinner or dessert? What should it be making at a certain time? How does a skin cell know what it should make? How does a pancreas cell know what it should make? And the answer to how gene expression is controlled is gene regulation. And there's a lot of different ways that cells regulate their genes, and I'm just going to introduce you to a couple of the main ones, but this is a much more in-depth area, and we're still doing a lot of research to understand gene regulation. It's been really well studied in bacteria and prokaryotic cells. It seems to be a little more complicated in eukaryotic cells like our own, and we're continuing to understand those differences. Why does a skin cell make melanin and a pancreas make insulin and not vice versa? That's going to be through control of gene expression. Gene regulation can either increase or decrease expression. So regulation might turn genes on, meaning a gene is now expressed more, or it can decrease or even stop gene expression. So control can be positive or negative control. Gene regulation can occur at multiple steps. The first one is simply whether the DNA is tightly coiled up or open and available for RNA polymerase to find its promoters. If the DNA remains tightly coiled up in a chromosome, then the RNA polymerase can never attach to it. And so that's one way to stop particular genes from being expressed. And they think this is one of the main ways that cell differentiation happens. In a skin cell, for example, the region of DNA that has the gene that codes for insulin is tightly coiled up, and so it's just never given the opportunity to be expressed in skin cells because you don't need it expressed there. Another way to control gene expression is initiation. Remember that transcription begins when the RNA polymerase finds the promoter and moves along the DNA. Now, I mentioned that there's other molecules that will attach to the DNA to let the RNA know that a promoter region is in the particular area, and we call these transcription factors. And those would act as enhancers. They're attracting the RNA polymerase to a place where it can start doing transcription. You actually have other transcription factors that can act as repressors, and what they can do is sit on top of a promoter region and block it so that the RNA polymerase cannot attach. So you're sort of standing in front of a doorway. There's nothing to see here. Can't come in. Nothing to transcribe in this area. These are key ways that hormones work and how cells communicate with other cells. Hey, it's time to do transcription. We're doing transcription. Here's some factors so you'll start doing it too. Or we're done growing. You don't need to make these anymore. So these are chemicals that move from cell to cell and either enhance or repress transcription and thus control gene expression. We also have protein processing and degradation. It turns out that the cytoplasm of the cell has specific enzymes that are constantly breaking down proteins that aren't being used. This is partially just to be efficient so that we can reuse those amino acids to build new proteins, but also we want the proteins used up and remade if we want a lot of them. It's a fine-tuned way for the cell to control how much of certain proteins it has by having them constantly being broken down and degraded, and then just more remade if they are continue to be needed. Messenger RNA also degrades. Remember in our restaurant analogy, messenger RNA is a copy of the recipe. And it turns out this copy is temporary. It only lasts for about an hour, and again, other enzymes in the cytoplasm will start to break it apart. So if a cell wants to make thousands of a particular protein, it's going to make hundreds of copies of that messenger RNA because each single messenger RNA will only be able to be read a couple times before it's thoroughly disintegrated. And again, this just gives cells more fine-tuned control about which genes are being expressed and to what degree. Finally, RNA processing or alternative RNA splicing turns out to be a really important form of gene regulation in eukaryotic cells. Remember, eukaryotic cells are cells with a nucleus. And this picture illustrates what we mean by alternative splicing. It turns out in eukaryotic DNA, we have in a particular gene sections called exons, and then in between, these are called introns. And it turns out that the introns are not part of the final messenger RNA. There are small segments that need to be edited out before we get the final piece of messenger RNA. So here we have a piece of DNA. It's going to go through transcription to make a piece of messenger RNA. And then the messenger RNA is going to be spliced by a couple other kinds of little RNAs, and they're going to cut out these segments. And so here we end up with a full messenger RNA transcript. This is then going to move to the cytoplasm, find a ribosome, and go through translation. And here we have this three-dimensional shape created by this particular gene. When the spliceosomes are splicing out the introns, they could cut right here and right here, right here and right here, and cut out all those introns. But there's also the potential that they would cut right here and then right here, and we would lose exon 3 from a transcript. And this is an alternative splicing. And so here you can see that we have parts 1, 2, 4, and 5. And the resulting protein is related to the first protein, but it's missing this little segment that was coded for by exon 3. And here we have a third transcript that came from that very same gene. And a typical human gene can actually be spliced into 3 to 7 alternative messenger RNAs. This actually explains something that confused scientists for a long time. It turns out that we only have about 25,000 genes in the human genome, but we make upwards of 100,000 proteins. And no one could understand how we could go from that many genes to that many different proteins. But alternative splicing explains this. Now, the controls of alternative splicing and when do we make this and when do we make this is still a big area of research that we're still trying to understand. I'm hoping at the very least you're just impressed with the complexity of how cells work here and how they very carefully regulate at many different steps which genes are being expressed, how much protein's being made, and making sure the right protein is made in the right cell.